medieval Europeans that it helps to kind of have a grip on the sort of context.
Very good. Okay, all right, so are you good to go?
Yeah.
All right. So, without further ado, Jean Chandler, New Orleans.
Hey, so like Jeff said, I'm Jean Chandler from New Orleans. I'm a fencer, like most of you are. I'm not an academic. I'm not even really a real researcher. I'm an aggregator. I'm like kind of a second-rate version of what Mike does. But I was stationed in Army in Germany in Augsburg, and like many of you folks, when I discovered HEMA, it stimulated me to do a lot of research, many unpaid hours in front of a computer. And I've been writing a book on the medieval Baltic that I'll probably never finish. I'm going to use some of that research in my lecture today. I'd also like to take a page from Mike and apologize in advance to anybody that's a native Polish or German speaker, because my pronunciation is terrible. Because I have to cover a lot of ground, if you could keep questions for the end, it would be probably better. And I'm going to have to read some stuff. I'm not as familiar with this, and I've never done public speaking before, so I'm going to be reading a little bit of stuff from this, but later on in the lecture I'll just be going off the slides. So since the early days of circle fencing, we've come a long way toward unlocking the mysteries of these fencing systems. We're starting to make a little bit of sense of them, as we saw yesterday on some very good fencing from some people other than myself. Thanks to people like Mike and Dr. Forgang, we've got some insight into the provenance of the Fechtbücher now that we really didn't have before. And we even know a few details about the lives of some of the authors, but we don't know much about the world that they lived in. A lot of them seem to kind of hang in blank space. And each new revelation about their lives often just introduces more questions. Who were they really? Were they training for sport or war? And why do Italians fight naked with rapiers? This is not going to be a Rosetta Stone proving the hidden origins of the KDF. I'm not going to initiate you into the secret mysteries of the Marx Scooter or read you the minutes of Lincoln in our society. What I hope to do is build up a little bit of this world around, because what I've found in the research that I've been doing is that it is fascinating, very entertaining, but there's just an enormous world out there that we really don't know almost anything about. It's a lot different than the expectations that we have from films and most of the genre literature that we're all familiar with. Specifically to do with who the authors of the books were and who were the practitioners of the fencing arts. We know of some links to some of these authors to the knightly classes. Like Mike was talking about Ringet earlier, he's a henchman of a lord. We know a few of them that were linked to the church. There's actually at least three that were priests. We also know quite a few that were linked to the middle classes, or the burghers, the people that lived in the towns. And this is a little bit more perplexing for a lot of us, because we kind of hoped they would all be knights, badass killers, ninjas like Mike. And it's got people worried about whether is this just a sport or wasting our time learning some kind of painful version of tag. There's different narratives about how this went. Some people say, well, it started out about killers and Tiger Mike and all that, and then later on evolved into this annoying sport. In my presentation, I'm gonna point out a couple of things that might look a little different. So, most of the members of the fencing guilds and some of the authors of the Fechtbücher were part of a specific estate, the artisan class of the medieval town. Many of the urban craftsmen linked to the KDF reside in a special type of medieval town called a free city. Most of the books and manuscripts associated with the KDF were also published or produced in these free cities. The free cities were formidable military powers in the medieval world, and warfare was a part of life for medieval burghers. It took many forms which followed both formal and informal rules, but burghers in general were warlike and skilled in the arts of warfare. All the central European towns relied on their walls and their militia for survival. And the craftsmen of the artisan classes who built the walls also formed the core of the town militia. And finally, the journeymen of the craft guilds had their own distinct armed societies, which had direct link to the KDF, and I think played a distinct and critical role in it. So I'm going to start off my lecture with a description of the medieval estate
that was provided. Thanks.
Was provided to me by a Swiss attorney named Jörg Gassmann. And this actually kind of makes sense because Swiss law to this day is essentially medieval law. It's basically 600-year-old law. Under a medieval estate, under medieval law, the concept of equality before the law does not exist. In late medieval Europe, each person is subject to different laws under sometimes overlapping jurisdictions and has different rights and obligations depending on his or her birth, order of birth, sex, office, profession, marital status, property, and other external factors. Each member of society lives according to their estate, a package of rights and responsibilities which they either inherit or achieve through work, negotiation, or force of arms. The sum of a person's rights and duties is defined as his or her estate, which today only means land or person's assets when they die. In medieval times, the meaning is much broader. The word is derived from the Latin status. In medieval Europe, a person's property status, social status, and legal status were inextricably linked and formed that estate. Communities and princes, too, at each level had a different set of liberties, either meaning rights and entitlements. Today, each panoply of sovereign liberties, prerogatives, and authorities vests in government as a matter of course. It's a package. It's part of being in a country. But in medieval Europe, each was dealt with separately. The rights might include the right to hold court and over whom, the right to hold a market, the right, the authority over weights and measures, the right to mint coins, operate a mill or a smithy, mine salt or metals, levy tolls, build fortifications, and the right to hunt. All these were separate and could be for the same locality held by different persons. On the other side are the duties, the obligation to render personal service as labor for agriculture or construction, military service, the obligation to pay taxes, whether as money or in kind, or the obligation to furnish soldiers and their equipment. The more liberties that you managed to amass, and the more duties that you managed to avoid, the freer you were. A town is a special type of community and a unique type of state in the medieval world. A special type of town called a free city had basically all of the rights and very few of the obligations under feudal law. And this is where I'll be focusing our attention today. So we're all familiar with the French concept of the three estates, those who work, the peasantry, those who pray, the church, and those who fight, the nobility. Those estates general were based on representation in the regional diets or assemblies. In France, though, or England, where it was a strong monarchy, it's a huge difference from Central Europe or Southern Europe. It's really three different worlds. So these are the estates in the Holy Roman Empire, and there's no peasants in these estates. Back here are the prince electors and the emperor. On the right hand side are the prelates of the church. On the left hand side are the nobility, and these are the burghers, representation from the three cities. There's different breakdowns of estates in different parts of Europe. In some places the church was banned out of it. Some places the nobility was banned out of it, like in Switzerland. But I'm concentrating on the Holy Roman Empire. This is a pretty late map of the Holy Roman Empire in 1795. It's a cluster F-U-C-K. This is what the Holy Roman Empire was going all the way back to the Middle Ages. It was what we call today a failed state. There really is no central authority. Each one of these little colored areas represents a different authority. The red are actually free cities, and this is quite late, so you see there still was some even that far. The other colors represent either the territory of prelates, meaning princes, prince bishops or prince archbishops, or their representations of territory owned by different families of warlords, basically like warlords you'd have in Somalia or something today. Get it? So I had a conversation with Mike Chester leading up to this lecture where we talked about the day jobs of the fencing masters, whose day jobs we know, which is only a third of them maybe we have an idea what they did for their day job. But I broke it down into different estates. So we know of three that were priests, among the estate of those who pray. We know of about eight that were for sure either knights or henchmen of knights. We know of a series that were in the universities, which it's kind of interesting what Jeffrey was saying about the 133, that maybe it's not so much about what they called the religious back then, but kind of the schools. And we know a whole bunch that were associated with, that were craftsmen, that were craft artisans from the towns. And so they're from the estate of the burghers. So far, we don't know of any that were from the peasant estate, but we'll probably find some. I think we're going to find that there's kind of separate and overlapping traditions from each of these estates. And I've just indicated what some of these folks moved from one estate to another. Tahofer was a henchman, but he was also a burgher in Zurich at one point. Peter Bialy went to university, ended up in a guild. Sebastian Hussler was a printer who quit his job and became a landsknecht, and so forth. On the slide. A few years ago, Olivier Dupuis made a really cool report at Dijon, where he broke down the day jobs and a whole bunch of other information about everybody that applied to hold a fencing tournament in Strasbourg, a good portion of the 16th century. And he did a bunch of statistical analysis of this, and this is a breakdown of the principal day jobs of these guys, these fencing masters, who applied to hold fencing tournaments. There were up to 35 per year, quite a few of them, just in this small town of Strasbourg. Very small by our standards today. Almost all of these are craftsmen, and we see that furriers are prominent, which we know furriers are linked to the Marschbrüder. And a lot of them were some kind of leather workers. And then, we also have the Messerschmitt and the knife, the cutlers, the knife makers or contractors. There's a lot more in that report that I would love to get into, but I don't have time, but including this female fencing master that came to town one time. Mm-hmm. Next slide. So this brings us to what the city is. We have a lot of different ideas of what a medieval city is. This is kind of a romantic interpretation from the 19th century. Next slide. This is more familiar to us. This is from Jabberwocky, and it's like the typical filthy, depressing, plague-ridden, lice-ridden, economic backwater disaster that we think of usually today. Next slide. So this is a look at the real thing. This is the cathedral at Strasbourg, which was completed in 1439. At that point, it became the largest man-made object in the world. You really don't get a sense of the scale from this picture, but I'll show you some more. 35 stories tall with no rebar and no I-beams, and it's still there. It's 600 years old almost. After World War II, was shelled by the Prussians in the 19th century. Next slide. It's a 35-story sculpture, essentially. And if you look at some of the detail, it really is amazing. If you ever get a chance to go there, it's mind-boggling. And this thing, next slide, here you see the astronomical clock, and that's the organ. And it was put together by the craft guilds of Strasbourg. There were no university-trained architects that put this together. They call them architects, but they were the masters of the Masons Guild that were actually in charge of it. Next slide. This is a picture of Strasbourg from the Nuremberg Chronicles. It's the only one that had to have an extra piece because of how big the cathedral was. They called it Argentina. That's an old Roman name because it was a silver mine there. Next slide. This picture from the 17th century really gives you a better idea of the scale of the cathedral, but also how small the town is. And the original medieval town is behind these walls right here. It's only about 20,000 people. Somehow put this together. So I just kind of want to emphasize to you that the wealth and power of these small, tough towns, which you can see this is not a place you want to try to invade, and the skill of their craft artisans. These craftsmen are not what we think of a craft today, where you put together like a shirt out of popsicle sticks or something. Next slide. This is an early mountain. I'm going to go back to the early history of these cities. There was an earlier phase of urban life in Europe that was under the Roman Empire. When the Western Roman Empire sort of gradually started collapsing, different interpretations, 5th, 6th, 7th century, whatever you want to say, the urban life in Europe faded quite a bit, except for the Moors in Spain. But by around the end of the first millennium, we start to see some return of urban life. And I have an account by a Moorish Jewish merchant from Tortosa who traveled in Central Europe a little bit and wrote about it in 965 AD. He mentioned that the city of Mainz, which is now Germany, had pepper, ginger, cloves, nard, and galangal in abundance in their markets, which he noted all came from the Indies, from India and China. Prague, he described as a city built of stone and lime, already heavily trading with Krakow, with a thriving market for slaves, tin, furs, and sheep, flour, and animal fodder, as well as a well-developed leather industry. I was going to read that verbatim, but I don't have time to get into it. But this shows us that even 1,000 years ago, towns in Central Europe were already part of a very far-flung trading network, reaching all the way to the Indian Ocean and beyond. And some of them were made not of wood, but stone already. Their economies were thriving in well-developed craft industries. The trade that was thriving in Mainz and Prague in 965 is what led to the granting of market rights, which in turn led to the development of the other medieval towns by the period that we're interested in. So the cities that keep coming up in the context of the fencing manuals happen to, I don't think coincidentally, lie across major trade routes across Europe. So this is a map that I found online of all the trade routes. These are Hanseatic League in black, which is significant for us. Blue is Venice, and red is Genoa, purple is mixed. But I circled in red cities that we know have direct association with the Kunst des Fechten and also with the Italian tradition. And in blue, some of the other free cities. These are all also happen to be free cities. So in Central Europe, where there's a failed state, it's the free cities that are kind of holding up the culture and have all the economic power. In the kingdoms of France and England, it's a different story. It's a completely different context, and it's perhaps why they don't have the same manuals. Next slide. So founding these towns, because they were so lucrative economically, was in itself a business and was recognized as a valuable economic asset early on by the nobility and the church. So much so that founding the towns was done by professional surveyors called locators, who would be given a charter with certain monopolies in exchange for recruiting settlers and surveying and organizing a new town. In many cases, these towns were being set up in dangerous frontier zones subject to attack, or in unsettled areas where farmers were often the prey of robber knights and rampaging soldiers. So the solution for the towns was to fortify and create what they called a commune. I also wanted to interject here and point out that just as quite a few of us study more than one master to understand the KDF, it's similarly hard to understand these towns if you only look at them one at a time. Like the Fechtbücher, they're both cryptic in their practices and terminology, and they're also very closely interrelated. So just like German fencing manuals have certain elements in common like the Zettel, and yet each one is unique, many of these free cities in the German-speaking areas of Europe, which includes places far outside of Germany, share the same town charters and pass through many of the same stages in their history. As a result, they tend to have similar socioeconomic structure and even certain physical and architectural features in common. This correlation between the way the towns and the books kind of overlap in certain ways, I don't think is an accident. So for example, the city of Lübeck, which you see here on the slide, created its charter in 1226 AD, which is when they became a free city. This happened through a very complex and painful process involving wars, lawsuits, sieges, uprisings, standoffs, bribes, reprisals, and a lot of very careful legal arguments. So rather than going through the same ordeal, 27 other cities throughout Central Europe and in Eastern Europe, including Hamburg, Danzig, Rostock, Tallinn, and Novgorod in Russia, just adapted the Lübeck Charter when the conditions made it impossible. They just took the same charter. 29 cities throughout Central and Eastern Europe adopted the Magdeburg Charter. Quite a few in Southern Germany have adopted the Nuremberg Charter, and so on. Town charters delineated several important privileges, which typically include the right to self-governance, economic autonomy, criminal courts, and most important to us today, a militia. But one other thing I want to say about them that's very curious and is sort of counterintuitive for us today is that because they got their charter from these other towns, they actually would, that was the court of appeal. So they would, if you had a legal dispute in your town, you'd go back to the town that you got the charter from, which in case, some cases might be a much smaller and less important town. And so they were connected that way. Next slide. Wow. So you will see in all these, especially like for example, the Hanseatic cities, which are copies of Lübeck, you'll see certain similarities in the town layout. This is a map of Greifswald based on information from 1456. And go to the next slide. So like if you ever go on a Baltic cruise, you might be a little bit confused because you go in different countries, you're going to find that there is a St. Mary's Church in every one of these towns. And they're all copies of the original St. Mary's Church in Lübeck. Next slide. There's also a big town hall with a big clock and a tower. Next slide. which you'll also notice have certain similarities. There's that previous was Danzig, this is Krakow. Next slide. That's Turon, which is another city, formerly German city in what's now Poland. And next slide. So all these towns went through different phases. All the free cities typically went through certain phases that you see a lot of similarities in. So I made this chart to kind of show you what those were. Almost all these towns started off, they're very, very, very far back in history as settlements. So they were originally some kind of Germanic or tribal Celtic settlement or something like that. Krakow was supposedly a dragon's lair, so they're different. Nuremberg was found in the Middle Ages. But all the other ones were originally tribal center, then they became Roman administrative centers of some kind. A couple of them were major. And then almost all of them became either bishoprics, or in the case of Krakow, and Nuremberg, a royal seat, meaning like there's a king or an emperor that lived there a lot of the time. By around the first millennium, they were granted market rights, which is really significant. It basically meant that the aristocracy was not allowed to interfere in the market, and this made the market grow, and the town become suddenly much more prosperous. Very significant step for these towns usually happened in the 13th century was that their walls were proven. They usually had some kind of walls or fortifications. But when there was a major attempt to knock that town over and it failed, that was huge. And by the time all these cities had really proven their walls, they were usually never conquered again, ever. Or maybe for centuries and centuries and centuries. And this had to do with the fact that siege warfare kind of tended toward the defense in the Middle Ages. And also these towns were all situated on rivers. And the main way to beat a fortification was to tunnel under it. And it was harder to do on a river. So usually around the same time they got their town rights, meaning that it became kind of semi-independent. They went through a revolt against their bishop or archbishop. A lot of them had a bishopric. Several of them, like Strasbourg and Cologne, actually went to war, had a full-scale war with their bishop and threw him out. several of them joined the Hanseatic League, which meant they were connected with a whole bunch of other cities, and it gave them a lot of economic and military clout. They would be granted imperial immediacy or royal immediacy, which means that they were outside of the feudal system, that the only overlord they had was the king or the emperor. Usually the king or the emperor in these failed states was too busy fighting off other rivals and so forth. Effectively, it meant they were outside of the feudal system once they got immediacy. And that usually went along with them becoming a republic. And kind of the last stage that was significant for us is that most of them went through a guild revolt in the 14th century, where the guilds had an uprising against kind of the oligarchy in town, the town council, and what was called the patricians. And that could go any number of different ways, and quite often the guilds were brought into the government to some extent. In Nuremberg, the patricians won and they outlawed the guilds. So after 1349, there were no more guilds in Nuremberg, which is significant for our study of HEMA. In Strasbourg and Cologne, the guilds won, but they gradually allowed some of the patricians back in. Most of the towns, they have what's called a recess, which means backing down, meaning that they made a compromise. So they might have been one where there was more patricians in the government and more guilds, but it was some kind of combination. And I think this was the key to the success of these towns compared to the Italian towns that eventually got taken over by nobles that were part of members of the aristocracy. A lot of times were came out of their mercenaries. All right, next slide. So to give us an idea how some of this happened, I'm kind of drilling down a little bit into some specific cases that I got from a Polish history book from 1480. This is from the Nuremberg Chronicles. This is what the town of Germans called Breslau, and the Poles called Wrocław. I can't pronounce it properly, but I'll just say Wrocław for convenience. this is in the region of Silesia, where we have a lot of members of the Lichtenauer Society. I think it's a significant, important area for HEMA. A lot of the eastern part of Central Europe, what's now Poland and Czech Republic, is where we find a lot of these guys. I have a map, but I don't have time to get into it. Next slide. That was actually created for me by Michael Chidester. So this is early on in the history of Wrocław, 1248. Jan Długosz describes how one Polish duke decides to take over the region where Wrocław was in Silesia. He hired a big army to come in there. He burned up 500 men and women who were hiding in a church. He got to the city of Wrocław, and the duke of this region went and hid in his castle. He didn't have a big enough army to fight this guy off. And according to Dlugosz, he says, quote, rock law, which has recently been located under German law by Henry and is under the government of its Germans, has few inhabitants and is insufficiently equipped with the means of defense. Nonetheless, it bravely endures a siege of 3 months, during which, by frequent sorties, it inflicts damaging losses on the enemy, finally forcing Boleslaw to raise the siege with nothing accomplished. And then he tries again a year later and also fails and gets arrested by his own people when he goes back home. And this guy keeps trying to do things like that. But what happened as a result of this was that the Duke, whose territory was saved by the city, liked the city a lot more after that. And so he gave them more rights. And next slide. One of the rights that he gave them was the right to charter Krakow, which is our already existing city, but he gave the citizens of Rockwall the right to go to Krakow and locate it under German town law. And this is an example of one of the town charters. This is real, these are really important to those towns to this very day. Next slide. So here's here's Krakow from the Nuremberg Chronicles. And one of the things I point out about this is very typical of a medieval city, which are, again, very small. Krakow's about maybe 15,000 people, but it's actually three different municipalities. This is in the late Middle Ages, so by this time, there's the original Krakow, there's the castle where the church and some of the nobility live, which is separate from the city. Then there's Kazimierz, which is another town that was chartered as an economic rival to Krakow when the king was annoyed at them. And this is yet another municipality over here. Dlugosz, the Polish historian from 1480, goes on and describes how right after Krakow got their walls, right after Krakow got their charter, there was another case where a duke tried to take over from another duke in the same region. And this duke was outgunned, all of his guys had converted over to the other side, and he was really in trouble, and he couldn't even rely on any of his own knights. So he had to hide out in the castle in Krakow, and he needed to go run to Hungary to get reinforcements to save his bacon. And he couldn't take his family with him. So he had to entrust the citizens of Krakow, who were at that time mostly German, to save his family. And they actually did that. The other duke came, burned down what was then the city, but managed to fight off the invading army. And so this guy came back with his reinforcements from Hungary, fought off the rival duke, and then became so happy with the citizens of Krakow that he actually started cutting his hair like a German. But more significant for Krakow, he gave them the right to build real walls, which are these walls you see here, pretty much. And that was really good for Krakow because 2 years later, in 1287 AD, the Mongol horde made their third invasion into Poland. The first two times the Mongols came, the citizens of Krakow hid in the forest and let the town get burned down. Because when the Mongols came, it really wasn't a joke. It was big trouble. But this time, in 1287, the Mongols came, went up against these walls, and were defeated, which is a big deal. The Russians weren't able to do that for another 100 years. Dorak. next slide. The reason why they allowed these towns to be chartered twofold. The traveling merchant, which is here with a nice big messer, and then the oval shot water wheel, which allowed production. This type of water wheel increased the horsepower of water wheels by a factor of 10 and allowed them to set them up everywhere. A lot of production then, like today, is basically automated or it's powered production. And so this was all these towns were on rivers. This is what made them money. And this is why the nobility originally maybe made the mistake of getting the town rights to these towns. Next slide. Because what happened shortly after... go to the next slide. Shortly after they fought off the Mongols, the duke that they liked in that area died, and the nobility elected a different duke from Mazovia to come down and take over. But according to Jan Dlugosz, he says that the city fathers, mainly the butchers, at this time the chief guild, ordered the gates opened, took over the city, and this guy, Boleslav, had to flee the city, hide in a Franciscan monastery, jump over a wall, and the other duke took over. So basically Krakow decided who was going to be the duke of that district. And they started annoying the nobility quite a bit by them. But it's interesting that it's orchestrated by the butchers. Next slide. The other thing is that these walls that were made that fought off the Mongols were also made by the craft guild. This is the last one of like five remaining gates. This was the main gate of Krakow from the Middle Ages. dating back to the early 14th century at least, maybe all the way back to the 13th century. It's called St. Florian's Gate, but it's also known as the Furrier's Gate because the Furrier's Guild owned, built, and operated this gate. We think maybe they collected tolls going through it too. This is where their armory was. And we know the Furriers, of course, linked to the Marschbrüder. So that's kind of significant for us. Next slide. This is from an excerpt from another history book from the early 20th century, where the guy basically describes how after this famous event where they fought off the Mongols, every year at Corpus Christi Day, and every time there was a royal coronation, all the guilds would march through town in their armor with their swords bare to remind the city of the role they played in the city's defense, and also to remind them of some other things. And he goes on to point out that all these gates, the St. Stephen's, the Shoemaker's Gate, the Butcher's Gate, and so forth, were made by the different guilds, and he says the nicest one belonged to the Lacemaker's Guild. next slide. And here's the Carpenter's Tower, which is another one of the guild towers in Krakow, and behind that's the Joiner's Tower. So this kind of gives us an idea of how these towns kind of got their rights, and getting the gate, getting the walls had a big part of it, but even this early, back in the 13th century, it was the guilds orchestrating a lot of this. So next slide. This fast forward a little bit now to the Free City in the time of the fencing masters. This is a map that I modified of Danzig. And once again, you can see there's different municipalities in here. The Altstadt is the old city. The Reichstadt, the main town. The old suburb was controlled by a Franciscan monastery. This was controlled by another church, the Long Gardens. This is a Slavic village. This was the ducal palace, but the Teutonic Order owned it, and they wrecked it when the town threw them out. The other really significant thing is the water sources here. This is the Mutlowa. I'm probably mispronouncing that, Jake. This was their principal navigation channel, where all the ships came in and out of the Vistula River and the Baltic Sea. This was their water source. We have a tendency from like that Jabberwocky image of people basically just drinking sewage all day in the middle of the world. But that was not the case. This was one of two water sources for the city, and if you threw any trash in that river, you'd be executed. It's one of four crimes you could be executed for in Danzig. And it was also the power to their mills. Next slide. So here again, per that earlier image of the traveling merchant and the water wheel that I showed you from the 13th century, this is the 14th century crane in Danzig. It was powered by two human-sized hamster wheels. This would load and unload ships. And you can see it's a pretty formidable beast. They call it the Zurau. All these cities had these cranes, and they usually had their own little names. This is where the Great Mill, this is the Great Mill in the Radunian Canal that I was pointing out on the other map that powered this giant complex with 18 millstones and four trip hammers for processing metal. Millstones are for processing grain. And this is the small mill that had the sawmill in it, which was for their shipbuilding industry. Next slide. The other really important thing, per the not drinking sewage, this is the water system of the nearby city of Elbing, which is another one of the Prussian towns. This is the Kumiela Canal, which is their principal water source. It's diverted into pipes that went all throughout the city and fed these different wells, and in some cases went into certain houses. It's for two reasons. It's for fresh water, but it's also for firefighting, because that was a huge problem for medieval cities burning down all the time, which they did very frequently. Next slide. So kind of wrapping up on this idea of the cities. When I say city, it's not like what we think of today with 1 million people or 4 million people or something. These are little towns. There's about 4,000 towns in Europe, in Central Europe at this time. Average size, only about 2,000 people. There's 500 towns that were allowed to call themselves cities, which are a little bigger, maybe 5,000, and about 200 of these free cities. Part of that is because the population of the world was a lot smaller then. There's 400 million people versus 7 billion now. But part of it is just the social organization in these towns is just different. Being in one of these towns was a privilege. You couldn't just stroll into one of these towns and live there. It was almost like being part of a giant co-op business. Next slide. I also wanted to point out, per the significance of our fencing that we're interested in, this is a map of all the where all the books were printed before the 16th century. And you'll see some familiar names that we would associate with the fencing manuals, like Strasbourg, Augsburg, Nuremberg, Cologne, Venice. There's also a cluster of places where books were printed here in northern Italy, here in Flanders, and in central Europe around the Rhine region, and in the Hanseatic towns, as well as here in Catalonia and a few other places. These are also places that had paper industries going strong before the printing press was invented in the middle of the 15th century. And I think there's a link why, you know, again, why this is where a lot of sort of intellectual activity was going on in the Middle Ages. Not so much in France and almost none in England. Next slide. So getting into like what a town government was back then, I think this slide helps a lot to understand the difference between a town today and a town back then. This guy in the plate armor with the poleaxe is the mayor of Zurich. And he's right now regretting a decision that he made to put Zurich at war with the rest of the Swiss Confederacy, which was a mistake. And he paid with his life, but he fought off the army of the Swiss Confederacy on that bridge for a good half an hour while his fellow citizens escaped back into town. So this is something you don't see mayors doing often. The mayor, or burgomeister, was a totally different animal. There were usually typically four or five mayors for each municipality. You might have three or four municipalities in each town, and you know, each one of those is only 15 or 1,000 people or something for the whole town, so quite a lot of mayors. Next slide. So this rather complicated chart is a chart I made depicting the government of Strasbourg with the help of Olivier Dupuis, who lives in Strasbourg and has access to the records. Give you an idea of the weird political environment of a medieval city. This is a guild town, it's a particular type, meaning that the guilds had taken over the government, basically. So you have kind of two layers here. The top layer are the people who have the privilege of being taxed. Back then, that was a great thing. Because being taxed meant that you had rights. You were actually a citizen. This is about a third of the population of the town that are enfranchised in some way. Then you've got people who are not taxed. And these people are only provisionally citizens. They're citizens through somebody they work for. So like all the apprentices and journeymen, they work for different guild masters. Their citizenship is through them. And if they get fired, they're getting thrown out of town. We got foreign merchants, servants of the church. The government is a mixture of the patricians, who are kind of the, very, very broadly speaking, they're kind of the urban version of the nobility. They had lost the war, so they had less influence, but they, while the president of the city is elected from the guild, they have kind of the cabinet. And they were also brought back into the Council of 13, which is in charge of the guild defense, because, or the town militia, because the guilds realized they needed the patricians for the cavalry, because the patricians provided a lot of the cavalry in the town. Next slide. Breaking down the demographics of these towns, you have a small number of very rich people. The city council is always its own faction. Everybody always hated the city council if they weren't in it, regardless of what government it is. Then there's the patricians, who are very wealthy people, in some cases incredibly wealthy people. Some of these folks, like the Fuggers and the Welsers and the Medici and so forth, were loaning money regularly to emperors and kings. Then you have your professional layer, which is also small. The full craftsman, which means a guild master, those are the only people acknowledged as craftsmen. Which is a pretty small number still, and then all your apprentices and journeymen who have some hope of upward mobility to become craftsmen. Then you got shopkeepers and laborers, and a lot of servants who have really no rights unless maybe they can get into a guild. Next slide. And to sort of validate that, this is an actual tax roll from Augsburg to pay for the Burgundian War when they were fighting Charles the Bold. And you can see there's a very small number of really rich people. There's a fairly decent number of kind of what you might call middle class people that were paying a significant amount of tax for this war. And these folks up here are probably a lot of the journeymen and junior guild masters that hadn't really been established yet. Next slide. So the patricians are a whole urban class, something like the nobility, but really not. And I'd love to get into that, but I have no time. And finally, here, this is breaking down the urban demographics again. Craftsmen are a pretty small number in these towns. Danzig has less than some other cities because it's basically a mercantile town, but craftsmen are kind of an elite. We think of guilds as, just the lowest of the low, but they're depending on the specific craft, And like in a town like Oxford, where the weavers and the metalworkers were really powerful, being in that guild was a privileged position. Next slide. So this brings us to the militia. This is a picture from a 1392 deployment of the Strasbourg militia to war. It was originally from a stained glass window in the church, the cathedral. On the top here, you see the infantry deploying on carts, wearing full armor. Down here, you see the cavalry. All the infantry were from the craft guilds. And you can see their guild banners up here. I don't know what they all are, but I think that's a cooper, and those are shearers. That's a vegetable. But the infantry in all these towns and their militia came from the craft guilds, which is significant to us because we know the craft guilds were the guys who were doing a lot of fighting. Next slide. This is just a rather ugly looking chart that I made just to show you how many times these towns went to war in the Middle Ages. And I've just only included cities that were major free cities and especially the ones that were associated with the KDF. And you can see they weren't just fighting, you know, trivial fights of enemies like the Kingdom of Denmark, the Mongol Horde, the Kingdom of France, Poland, the Holy Roman Empire, the Teutonic Knights, Charles the Bold of Burgundy. They lost probably about as many as they won, but in none of these cases were the towns themselves ever captured. So these are expeditionary wars where they're fighting somebody else. Next slide. I was going to play this for you, but I didn't have time to hook up YouTube. This is an old Flemish song about arming the militia, and it's kind of ominous. It reads, the man, the armed man should be feared, everywhere it has been proclaimed that each man shall arm himself, quote, Iron Man. Kind of scares me a little bit. Next slide. This is an actual muster chart. This is like I said, the cities of immediacy had owed fealty to the emperor or the king. This just shows how many troops they owed in case of a major crisis, which wasn't too many. Strasbourg had to provide 30 cavalry and 200 infantry. Basel, 14 cavalry and 14 KDF associated towns. Next slide. This breaks down the militia of the city of Rostock in 1450. It's the number of armed and armored soldiers that all the different guilds had to provide. So this was a big trading city, so they had a lot of foreigners, 150 of those. But we see the shoemakers, the smiths, the cutlers, butchers, and the furriers, all pretty high up on the list, which we always see in these militias. And that's also significant for us. And I have to also say that, you know, given the, think of the skill of these craftsmen in building those cathedrals and stuff. Imagine a really skilled butcher. That if you ever see somebody butcher, an animal, like, or maybe, you know, a hunter taking apart a deer, who's also a trained fencer. Imagine like fighting somebody like that. A lot of these leather workers are used to cutting up animals too. The furriers, cutting up bears and wolves and so forth. Next slide. This drills down even further to, this is a little late for our period, 1615, but these are very common going all the way back to 14th century. It's a musterungsroll, if I mispronounce, which is all the individual people and what kind of gear they had to bring. So you can see that this guy's a Doppelsoldner. These guys are bringing muskets, halberd, and armor. This guy has a two-handed sword and armor. He's our guy. And so forth. So they specified what you had to bring was based on how much money you had, basically. Next slide. We know that they also had cavalry. Some towns had more cavalry than others, depending on how strong their patricians were, basically. Lübeck had 402 lances in one deployment in 1435. That's about 1,500 cavalry, because lance is the main guy with an armored horse, and he's got three or four guys with him. Strasbourg had less. They deployed 115 lances. 81 from the patricians, but also 21 from the guild. So some of the craft guild members were also cavalry. And in Wismar, the butcher's guild comprised the cavalry, apparently. Next slide. And so there's also quite a few cases where craftsmen are being hired as mercenaries. The most famous that we know of that everybody's heard about are the Swiss. A lot of the Swiss so-called Swiss mercenaries were militia from Bern, Zurich, and some other towns. This is just an example where Jean Hubosch talks about tailors, cobblers, and other artisans coming out of Rock Law to go terrorize Poland. And he specifically says that all the knights were scared, and One of them tried to attack them, and he found a glorious and memorable death. Next slide. This picture right here is from a wooden chest in Flanders. It depicts their astounding victory against the flower of French chivalry in the Battle of Golden Spurs. Remember we heard earlier, a two-handed mace? They called that the Golden Dog. Good morning, which is a big giant two-handed mace that they used to kill a whole lot of French knights and take their golden spurs and all their other knight stuff. This I also have a quote from Silvio Piccolomini, who was later on Pope Pius II. He says of the Germans, "Not only every noble, but every burgher in the guilds has an armory in his house so as to appear equipped at every alarm. The skill of the citizens in the use of weaponry is extraordinary." And it's significant that he mentions their skill, because we know they had equipment, we know they had armor and weapons, but he's talking about that they knew how to use them. Next slide. Which brings us to this idea of armed guilds. Guilds that were specifically oriented toward fighting. We know of some guilds in Bologna that go back to apparently 1170, which I'm going to get into in a second. Flemish guilds sometime in the 13th century. Then there's the Battle of Golden Spurs, where the towns beat the French really badly. More Flemish guilds, then the Marksbruder, the Fechtbücher. But the history of this does seem to go back pretty early in the Middle Ages, earlier than we originally thought a couple years ago. Next slide. So this right here is the front page of a book of statues, which was published in 1889 from the Bolognese armed guilds, based on original documents from 1240 AD. And Pierre Marco, some of y'all may know him, he's a fencer, a rapier fencer in England, he's half Italian, he speaks Italian. He gave me a summary of the Italian introduction to this book. The statues themselves are all in Latin and we haven't translated them yet. But he says that according to the Italian introduction, it says, "The book is about the militias that formed the core of the city's infantry. Most historians date their rise to about 1174 when the Lombard League was founded. There was 24 of these corporations by the middle of the 13th century in Bologna, with names like the Lions, the Griffins, and the Dolphins. These 24 were organized geographically with 5 societies for each quarter of the city, plus one for men from Lombardy, another from the Tuscans, and a group for the butchers. The purpose of these groups appeared to be both to quell civil unrest and for external defenses. They were lined up under their respective standards. Although this was their official purpose, they also served as mutual aid societies to protect against the aggression of the ruling classes and to aid members in times of poverty, bury the dead, and so forth. There was also a religious element with members attending masses together and so on. This is very common for all guilds. Their organization was based on the craft guilds, and they were typically governed by 4 or 8 members with an attendant council where they were able to elect bans and fines on their members. They also had a financial officer and a sindicato, which was something like an internal auditor. Important decisions were made by a general assembly that decided the statutes, expenses over a certain amount, new members, and expelling people. And it seems like they were involved in some faction wars where they expelled the Lambertese family. Next slide. And one other note on the craft, or the armed guilds. This is an interesting activity, which is called shooting the popinjay. And a lot of the early armed guilds were shooting guilds, guns or crossbows or bows. Shooting the popinjay is where they would put a wooden parrot on top of a pole, and it was actually made to come apart like a puzzle with different prizes on the different pieces, and they would shoot them. And this slide is from this picture on the right is from a book published in Krakow in 1505 about the guilds. And it's interesting because Jan Długosz has a passage where he's complaining about how his house almost got burned down during a big fire because all the apprentices in town were outside of the city walls shooting the popinjay. And you can see these guys, I don't know if they're apprentices or what, but one of these guys got a longsword for a sidearm, and they're dressed like popinjays themselves, but they also look like they can kill you. Next slide. So this brings us to the guilds. What were they? Here's another colorful chart that I'm very proud of. It doesn't actually give you anywhere near the complexity of the real breakdown of all the guilds and everything, but it gives us a little overview. And once again, I kind of colored this based on the estates involved. So the earliest guilds that we know of were actually merchant guilds. The guild is defined by a lot of modern scholars, particularly certain ones that I've been, books I've been reading.
as differentiating from other craftsman associations that they had around the world up to that point, in that it's made up of people who aren't part of the same kin group. Everybody who actually happens to be in this town, if you're able to do this job, you're part of the guild. You're voted in. It's like a family that's artificially created. So the earliest ones were called conjurations, which meant this idea of a juror meant a peer, and it was a confraternity of jurors, and this term conjurations became pejorative in the black magic sense later on when the nobility and some of the emperors tried to ban guilds. So the earliest ones were basically had to do with life insurance, because these guys were merchants that were traveling around on ships and subject to pirates and bad weather and everything else. But around the 13th century, we start to see these merchant guilds evolving into very fancy grand guilds. There's the ones that are in the area that I study, a lot of them were called the King Arthur Court. They had all these ideas of chivalry and so forth. They even had a round table and everything. These guys were really rich. Around that same time, you start seeing the craftsmen forming their first guilds. And you start also seeing the first armed guilds, like this one's in Bologna. By the 14th into the 16th century, the patricians have created companies. So you've got like the Medici, the Fuggers, the Wellesley. They're the big banking empires of Europe. They've also created the Hanseatic League. And they've created these Konstaffler societies where they've basically recreated the idea of being knights. They do tournaments and everything, and they fight on horseback. A lot of the craft guilds merged together into larger guilds for more political and economic power. It was a lot of times involved in taking over the towns. And these guilds were linked together by what they call in academia religious sodalities. In New Orleans, we call that a social aid and pleasure club. A lot of other places, they call them benevolent associations. And these have heavy connections to carnival, which also a couple of our fencing masters do as well. So they would hold parades and big parties. They had sort of insurance for each other. They all went to the same churches. They fetishized the saint that was in charge of their guild, like St. Vitus, which we also associate with a certain fencing guild, the Fechtbücher, or St. Mark with the Marsh Brewer. This guild, the religious guild, connected the fencing guild, the craft guild, and the journeyman's association. The journeyman's would also have their different sodalities, because journeymen were the next stage after becoming an apprentice. If you're accepted as an apprentice, you're basically an indentured servant. You've won this wonderful right to work for free for about 3 years. If you manage to do that without getting in trouble, then you graduate to being a journeyman. Back then, a journeyman meant somebody that had to travel. You had to go on a journey. You're banished from the town that you grew up in. You had to stay out for at least 3 years, sometimes up to 7 years. And you would travel around looking for places to find work and learning about the world. And because there's some association and crossover between journeymen specifically and the KDF, I think that a lot of the circulation and these stories about masters traveling around may be connected here. I know Albrecht Dürer isn't considered a master or a fencing master, he just wrote a book, but he went on his journeyman years. That's where he met his wife and his principal patron, Jacob Fugger. So next slide. So this is going to give us a little insight into the guild life. This is a book published in Krakow in 1505. Which I really wish I had a translation of, because it has like every detail about all the guilds, including militias and stuff. But I don't have a translation, but we have these nice pictures of different guild workshops. So this is a tailor's guild workshop. I think that's the proprietor and that's the proprietress, and these are probably customers. Next slide. This is a tanner's guild. Significant thing about this is that other than they're playing cards and they have a weird dog, they're actually outside of the city limits, because in the Middle Ages, they thought that bad smells caused diseases, and they were very scared of diseases. So any bad-smelling business, like an abattoir or a tanner, had to be outside the city limits, which sucks for him if the Mongols come in, which they sometimes did. Next slide. This is a painter's guild, atelier, I don't know how to pronounce that. These guys in the long coats with the fur lining, as Jake will, I think, support me on, this is a traditional outfit of the Polish nobility. It's a type of specific fashion that they made up. Because they decided they were descended from the Sarmatians, so they made up this whole idea. And there was a whole lot of Polish nobility, and one of the largest nobilities, a sixth of the population was in the nobility. Next slide. So those were his customers, I think. This is an outside view of a blacksmith shop, but it gives us a nice picture, idea of what the city was like then. Next slide. This is a bellcaster's workshop. Bellcasters were important because they also made cannons. And casting a bell that size was a late medieval development. Once again, I think this guy's a Polish nobleman, so these guys are dressed more like in the German style. The population of the city was mixed then, but they sort of spoke German and used the German fashion and so forth. Next slide. This is a Carpenter's Guild workshop. There's a few more people working in here, and a couple of them are probably female. We think that about 15% of the guilds were female. This is also counterintuitive for a lot of people. Next slide. This is a Messerschmitt's Guild workshop, which is significant for us, since the Messerschmitts are connected to KDF. And also, as we know from Peter Johnson's lecture, if you guys got to see that, the Messerschmitt was a contractor that worked with the blacksmith and the iron forgers and all these other people that made up the sword. And these guys were designing. So once again, I see a Polish customer here. Maybe it looks like he's a little annoyed. I think that's a servant. This is, I think, the guild master himself, and these are his journeymen. You also see there appears to be different ethnicities. That's also very common. Next slide. This is from a different book. It's from Nuremberg, where they did not have guilds at this point, but it's an almshouse for craftsmen. When they died, they painted a picture of, it's a beautiful book, and there's thousands of these pictures, or several hundred anyway, but they paint a picture of the guy, what he did in his life. This guy is also a Messerschmitt, and interestingly enough, he had a dual career that he was a Landsknecht, a mercenary. That's him there, too. Earlier, happier time, I guess that's him, too. Next slide. Shoemaker's Guild Workshop from Krakow again. That's the proprietress, I think, and it's her baby. That's that's like a servant playing music. Journeyman apprentices and possibly a real chicken or maybe a wooden chicken and a bunch of shoes. Next slide. This is another one from Nuremberg. I just really like this one. It's a weaver. And I just think it's a beautiful picture of this craftsman at work. Next slide. Shopkeepers. Shopkeepers were in the guilds. We think of a merchant today as somebody who owns a shop, but once again, this is a downgraded concept. Back then, a merchant was like what we would call today a broker or a banker. Next slide. And here's a crossbow maker's guild workshop, which I think is really interesting, although I only have it in black and white. And this looks like the proprietor to me and a couple of customers checking out crossbows. And maybe his wife doing the books and different apprentices and journeymen, one of whom is female. Next slide. So from those pictures, you kind of get a sense that there's little small workshops, but the guilds, again, had a lot of power. And to emphasize that, this is the guild hall from Hildesheim, Germany. I think this is 15th century. Next slide. Here's several from Zurich that also date back to the 15th century. They're all fancy restaurants and hotels now, but wool weavers, butchers, blacksmiths. Next slide. Carpenters, tailors. Next slide. So here's a couple of guild regulations to give you an idea what kind of world they lived in. This is for the Skinners Guild, which again sort of overlap for us. Furriers and Skinners are connected. I'm just going to read a couple of them. As soon as a brother in their guild dies, two brothers shall watch over the corpse, and all brothers and sisters shall contribute to that, and no one shall go away before it is buried. Whoever goes against this shall give two groschen to the guild or be held in arrears. So the idea of life insurance was still a big thing for the guild. And also, you couldn't allow anybody in your guild to be dishonored if they're dead and somebody makes fun of them or something. You basically got to kill that person because the honor is really important and it diminishes their status. Next slide, or next one. No one shall do poor workmanship on a woman's leather kirtle. Whoever should do this must pay a ton of beer for each offense. A lot of the fines are beer. If anyone shall hire another man's apprentice before his appointed day, he pays a ton of beer. Again, however, don't drink too much. He who drinks until he's so drunk that he vomits shall pay a half ton of beer and one mark worth of wax.
So you got an idea that
the guild masters are drinking a lot, but they're pacing themselves. This is a European thing, if you've ever been here. He who does something against his honor shall be closely associated with the profession as the members desire. Meaning, if you dishonor yourself, you can be thrown out of the guild. Next slide. So these are some regulations from the Shearers Guild in Arras and Flanders, which directly relate to fighting. These are translated for me by Arielle Lema. She gave me permission to use this.
But I found them.
Whichever brother of the fraternity of shearers does not come to the militia when it's called shall not remain in the city unless it's through the alderman, and 20 sous should pay to the confraternity. Meaning you can be banished if you don't show up to the militia muster. There was two forms of banishment, a year and a day or 100 years and a day, which is permanent. Banishment was one of the most feared punishments. Whichever of the brothers does not come out with the burgermeister the first night, the militia overnights, owes 10 sous. burgher militias did not like staying the night over outside of the walls, which was a big limitation on their use militarily, and for good obvious reasons. If any brother begins to mix it up after the militia has been quieted, he owes 40 sous to the confraternity, saving that's owed to the Lord. Meaning that if they say stop fighting now and you keep fighting, that's the way a lot of times armies got unraveled and destroyed. So maintaining discipline was really important. And at the hour the mayor and the alderman call the brothers to arm, he who does not arm owes 10 sous. So there's a lot of these kind of regulations where they go into having your armor and not losing it and so forth. Next slide. So this gets us to journeymen. So these guys are not dressed up for a Halloween party. They're modern journeymen in Germany, where they still have guilds. And these were actually preserved in Switzerland and a few other places. They were briefly ended in Germany in the 20s and through the Nazi era. The Nazis didn't like them. But they came back, and now they still have this tradition very strong. And these guys are in the Carpenters Guild. They do go on the road for 3 years. And we have a colleague that's a stonecutter, that's Payson Mueller in the city of York in England. And they're rebuilding the cathedral there, or they're fixing it up. And he gets a lot of these guys coming through, and they're helping him translate stuff, because a lot of them come from different regions in Germany that have different dialects. Next slide. So it's still alive. This slide is pretty important. It's not a pretty slide, but this shows you where all the journeymen came for just this one city in Munich, for just one guild, the Tailor's Guild. And you can see, and the size of the circle shows you how many came from each place, but they came from all the way from Prussia to Italy to Hungary, France, the Netherlands. Just out of 376 guys for just one guild, for just one town, they come from all over Europe. So this gives you an idea of the circulation of the journeymen all over, especially Central Europe, which I think this is why we have certain commonalities in the culture and in things like fencing. Next slide. This is talking about, I mentioned before, sodalities. So they're talking about the journeyman sodalities that started to come up. The journeymen eventually started having a little strife with the guild itself, and that's where we think of guilds as kind of like trade unions today, but a guild is really a group of owners, so in a way almost more like a chamber of commerce. Journeyman society started with what became trade unions. But they were also involved heavily in carnival. So for example, the Shoemakers Guild journeymen had a bath walk where they'd walk through town in their bath clothes and their soap and their scrub brush and so forth. The bakers used to have a Christmas tree with cakes, and they'd go to the poor people and shake the tree, and cakes would come down and they'd get to eat it. Bathing was another real important thing, a social event every Saturday. You would go bathe, and even the journeymen, the apprentices were given money for that. Next slide. Part of what these sodalities were involved in was also had to do with fighting. So here, in this particular 19th century book, he mentions that the shoemakers and the smiths did dance the sword dance, and that this indicated they had some skill at arms. And when I first brought this up to some colleagues, they were like, well, the sword dance, what, like Morris dancing? What does that have to do with skill at arms? But we're going to get to that in a minute. They also mentioned, there's a regulation here, they mentioned that journeymen had limited on the size of the swords and dagger they could carry in Frankfurt because of some disturbances. Next slide. So the sword dance, these are found by Roger Norling. He gave me permission to use these wonderful slides, and this is an activity that I think we should do at one of these events, although I cannot be the guy. I'll pull somebody
up. I'll volunteer for that.
But you will see that, next slide, some of these guys look like they're doing a kind of ridiculous Morris dance thing, like we've also seen actually still going on in Czech Republic and Slovenia and a bunch of other places. But these guys kind of look like they're fighting, and look at these blades. You see anything interesting about that? Next slide. This, if that wasn't clear enough, look at these. And they definitely look like they're fighting to me. And I think we could do this, and I really want to see it done. next slide.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry, go back one. You'll see also that these guys have what I would call like a fetter shirt, maybe, these guys have regular longswords, and this is pretty late. And the longsword did actually, was also used as a sidearm for craftsmen, going quite late. Next slide. Once again, I don't really buy the squareness of these ones, but who knows, we'll try it. Next slide. So that brings us finally into warfare in the Middle Ages. So like everything else in the Middle Ages, what I found out was that my expectations of what warfare was like is really different than what it seems to turn out to be. So that's why I picked this slide, which is from a wonderful map by a Swedish cartographer called Olaus Magnus. Guys in plate mail fighting on skis with bows. fighting with a reindeer, you know? A lot of the things
things on that map, though, have turned out to be very accurate. And this includes fighting on skis, although I don't have time to get into that. Next slide. So one of the first types of warfare that you had to have in a town was, unfortunately, civil war. This is a depiction of a civil conflict between the Guelphs and the Ghibellines in, sorry for mispronouncing that, in Bologna in the 14th century. Scary. It looks pretty nasty. And these tended to get out of hand in the Italian cities. In the German cities, they kept it under wraps a little bit more, simply for the reason that if it got too out of hand, they would pay a heavy price. So when I showed you earlier that chart of all the wars that the cities were in, and I mentioned that none of them had been captured, there were two cases where free cities were captured, both cases by the archbishop. Bremen was briefly captured by their archbishop for a few months, but they managed to kick him out. And the city of Mainz, where the first printing press was built, was captured by their archbishop as a result of a civil war. The losing party, which was some patricians, went to this guy and said, look, you know, you want to be in charge of the city again? Oh, yes, I would like to be in charge of the city. Takes over with the help of some of the citizens, slaughters about 500 of them, takes all the money from most of them. That's why Gutenberg left and went to Strasbourg. Changing history forever. Next slide. Here's another more apparently fun version of civil strife from Strasbourg. And the caption of this reads, look at the night raven fighting Cyclops while Romeo causes disturbance. Thrust, cut, hit, throw, brave with power, cleanse like the previous night. So I guess they're fighting the town watch here and having a ball doing it. It kind of reminds me of New Orleans in the 80s. these, I think, are journeymen, again, and they often were probably in trouble. The town watch was not professional police like we have today. They're actually other citizens. So this is because they didn't trust professionals to do the job. Next slide. So another significant part of medieval warfare is the rather depressing reality of the raid. This is some poor village. You can see this guy having a terrible day. It looks a little bit like some of the fencing I saw yesterday with the knife fighting. Stab, stab. This guy's being captured. This guy's already tied up. He's probably going to be a serf now. This woman's trying to hit a guy with a broom, but he's taking off her cattle. The rest of his village is hiding in the church, which is going to be pretty common. But a lot of the war just amounted of, like, you've made me mad, so I'm going to kill some of your villagers, and then in revenge, you're going to kill mine. And, well, I'm really mad about that, but, you know, I didn't die. Next slide. Then you had robber knights. This was a pretty major problem. In one of the part of the failed state aspect or the chaos of the Holy Roman Empire was that you did have these robber knights. And some of them were knights errant that would travel around supposedly looking for dragons or other knights. But since there weren't too many dragons and other knights were dangerous, they would tend to just rob people and take all their stuff. robber baron or robber knight was a guy who had a castle. And if he was lucky, he had one, say, next to a river. They'd put a chain across the river and charge a toll to every ship that went by. So the towns, actually, just in the last 30 years of the 14th century, destroyed 100 castles of robber knights because they were interfering with trade. So this is a significant enemy for them. Next slide. Just to emphasize how much trouble these robber knights could be, and also just for my kind of loving to make fun of English people, this is Henry of Bolingbroke, who became Henry IV. He was on his way to the Prussian Crusades when, according to his own memoir, which I have a copy of, but unfortunately it's in Latin, he was shamefully mishandled by robber knights in Saxony, and he lost a whole lot of money. Next slide. Then you also had dangerous peasants. Sometimes, like, this guy looks like he's in the Taliban to me. Most areas of peasants were just underfoot, you know, victims, but some of them were pretty tough. Next slide. This is one of the groups that was tough. They also have really amazing pants, like this guy. But you also see most of these guys have weapons and beer. And this guy, and their wives are bringing them beer, which is really nice and touching, I think. But you see this guy has a piece of a boat and an oar here. As part of their fun activity was their wreckers, meaning that they used to pick up wreckage from ships, like if you imagine a container ship wrecking and all the stuff that's in a container ship and how nice that would be. So the king of Denmark tried to invade this area, and this is in northern Saxony, four times. One of the kings of Denmark got killed doing it. None of them succeeded. The Germans from nearby districts tried as well three or four times and couldn't do it. So the cities of Hamburg and Lübeck made a deal with them and said, look, you're now our coast guard, and if any of our ships wreck, or if you're, you know, don't shine lights and make them wreck, you know, you can rescue them and bring them back and we'll pay you a fee. And they actually were brought into the Hanseatic League because of that. The most famous cases of dangerous peasants would be the Swiss and the Bohemians, who were major players in the warfare at that time. Next slide. Piracy and trade. So this is a map, kind of an ugly map. I'm sorry I couldn't do better with this, but this is all the major trading partners of just the city of Danzig. Danzig's only 30,000 people. Big city by medieval standards, but it's nothing by today's standards. Each one of these towns all over Europe and a little bit beyond was such an important trading partner of Danzig that they actually had permanent residents living in Danzig, or Danzig had permanent residents living there. And this also had to do with how fluid ethnicity was in its time. But so to maintain this trade, which kept Danzig alive, they had to be able to safely move their ships around. Next slide. This, if you guys have ever searched for the Fencing Master Peter von Danzig, or the pseudo Peter von Danzig, you may have seen this image before, been a little confused, like I was. This is a warship called the Peter von Danzig, which was actually, just like I said earlier, that the mayor was not like a mayor of today. The city council of today, which are really annoying people that you see mumbling on TV in a monotone about stop signs or something. This ship was a pirate ship commanded by a city councilor of Danzig named Paul Bernacki. And see the fighting positions up here for gunners and crossbowmen up there. Next slide. Its most famous exploit during the Anglo-Hanseatic War, which the city of Danzig and Lübeck won against the Kingdom of England, they captured this wonderful triptych, which I'd love to talk to you about. But I can say that the patron of the triptych is this guy right here, who's being judged worthy as Thomas Portinari of the Medici. But it created a huge international incident when they captured that that triptych. Next slide. This is a warship from Lübeck. It was a little more formidable. Next slide. It's a model of it in Lübeck, in their Ratskeller, or their town hall. I'd love to get into this, but you need to know there's this whole piracy thing. It's not just in the 18th century. There's a whole fascinating history of piracy in the Middle Ages, both in the northern area of the North Sea and the Baltic and down in the Mediterranean. Absolutely crazy fascinating, but I can't get into it. Next slide. So, and then finally, the pitched battle of the full-scale war. And I'm kind of emphasizing a little bit here the war wagon, because this was not too well known. It looks awkward and ridiculous in this picture, but these were extremely effective. So pretty much everybody's heard of the Swiss, and we all know how the Swiss revolutionized warfare, but in Central Europe it was the Bohemians that kind of brought the guns to warfare, and these war wagons, which, you know, it looks ridiculous, but you can kind of see a little Mad Max in there. And they brought this to fore during the Hussite Crusades, when basically all of Europe decided to smash Bohemia, and in turn got themselves smashed, and failed utterly in trying to suppress the heresy going on there. Next slide. This is from Bellafortis, which Mike was talking about earlier. Another, I don't think, very realistic war wagon, but we do have a little size on the side. And armored fighters. Next slide. This is a modern depiction, but I think it's probably a little closer to the ballpark. We know that the Czech type of war wagons had this particular layout, and you see there's a lot of guns and stuff. This is the Czech flail, or the flegel, which you see actually Paul's Hector Meyer and a couple other, and this was a really also important military weapon. This war wagon system is an emphasis of how the burghers went to war. They brought their technology and their skills with them to the battlefield, and this is how they even the odds with the nobility. They had their heavy cavalry and stuff. Next slide. So this is a depiction of a medieval army going to war from the Mittelalterliche Hausbuch von Schloss Wolfegg. It's a housebook like what Mike was talking about earlier. It's sort of a scrapbook, but they would have all their secrets in these housebooks, and this has a lot of really cool stuff in it. I recommend looking this up online, because it's a ton of really neat pictures. You see some scouts ahead, mounted crossbowmen and lancers. Then you see the main body of cavalry here. And then here you see war wagons. And in the middle, supply wagons, and up here, more war wagons. Next slide. These are scouts. These crossbows are a reflection of high technology of the burghers, because unlike what you see on the History Channel, this was not a simple thing that any idiot could use. At this stage, late 15th century, these crossbows could be up to 1,200-pound draw. They were spanned by a jack like you lift your car up with, called a crannikin. Both the bow and the jack itself were extremely expensive. And if you screwed up and that string snapped or the prod snapped, you're going to die. But if you knew what you were doing, it was deadly. They're very good at killing horses, which made it help them even the odds with the Mongols.
and the Turks and other enemies in that area. Next slide. Another. These guys are scouts, which is also real important for these medieval armies. It's sort of pioneered by the Hussites as well. Next slide. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Musicians, drumming. We've been talking about that in fencing. That's also really flutes and drums. Here you see gunners. Up until around the middle of the 15th century, gunpowder itself had to be mixed in the field because corn powder hadn't been invented yet. So if you went around with it, it would separate out into its component materials. So anybody that's using a gun often had to know how to make gunpowder. Even if you had corn powder, you had to know how to handle gunpowder to where it wasn't going to blow up. You know, which is, and all these guns, these are called pistola, which is a type of gun invented by the Czechs, although this book comes from Austria. But it means flute, pistola. But these are touch-hole firearms. So you have a lit fuse, and you touch it when it's ready to go. Obviously, if you got a bag of gunpowder right there, or, you know, it's a tricky thing. So these are skilled guys that know how to use these weapons. You notice also wearing armor. Next slide. Here's the heavy infantry. Again, this would be what the militia a lot of times use. See, this guy's clearly got a messer as a sidearm. This guy's got an arming sword or a long sword. Next slide. Here is that same army deployed for defense, and you see all the war wagons. This one's got the little mantlet open for the cannon there. They have these relatively small cannons. Somebody's getting stabbed over a dice game over here. Unpleasant. Here's somebody being brought in a captive. Very Mad Max to me, even though it looks kind of goofy. Next slide. Here's a little bit more of a fancy war wagon, which if you guys are familiar with Taillefer's Belle of Fortis, there was a big thing on the History Channel where they were kind of confused about what this meant, this weird axle layout. But it's this thing right here. So this is you know, a bunch of guns sticking out of the side. Looks like they got a battering ram on it. Next slide. So this gives you an idea of the terrifying reality of a full-scale medieval battle. This is the Battle of Orsha in early 16th century, but the Poles were still kind of in the Middle Ages then. The Poles are fighting the Russians. These are the Poles with the armored horses and the armor. But if you're reading about the history of this battle, if you read up about it on Wikipedia, it says what actually happened is that the Poles fought the Russians for a while, then they did a feigned retreat where they ran away. The Russians chased them, and they were led into an ambush where all their Bohemian mercenaries, which were mostly from Prague, were waiting with their war wagons, and they wiped out the Russians with guns. So I'm looking at this beautiful painting, and I'm thinking, where's my war wagons? And I finally saw them way up here in the corner. Next slide. That's them waiting with their guns. The wagons. They're the ones who won the battle, but they probably didn't commission the painting. Next slide. finally, just a couple other anecdotes that I don't have time to read through, but Rockloff fought a pitched battle with the King of Bohemia, George Podobrady, who was a bad mofo himself, and Rockloff won. Krakow had standoff. There's the mention, and these are all from Jan Dwugosz. They talk about how the citizens of Krakow had to go meet with the Polish king, and the Polish king happened to have a lot of bodyguards then that were heavily armed, and so the town showed up, all the citizens showed up with arms, and they had to sign a bunch of agreements before they could even get near each other, because they didn't trust each other at the time. And then Vienna captured the Holy Roman Emperor because he tried to tax him a whole bunch of money. And they kidnapped him and then got his brother to come and take him away. These are just some examples of these towns fighting with kings and emperors. Next slide. Towns versus the church. This is supposedly the oldest bar in the world. This is the Rakwa Town Hall, or Ratus. And I don't have really time to get into it, but they fought a war with their bishop over beer sales. The bishop was selling some beer that the town council had a monopoly in this bar, and the bishop had some other beer called Schops, which was better than the beer they had, and everybody was buying it, and they went to war over it, and they all got excommunicated, and the cathedral got ransacked, and a bunch of other terrible things happened. Next slide. These are statues that they have still all over Central Europe and Germany. These are called Roland statuen. They're statues of Roland, which is, you know from the troubadour romances. They represented, they all, you see them usually with the same posture, with the sword in the right hand, represented resistance to the church. And this is because a lot of times the towns themselves used to be owned by a bishop or an archbishop. This one in Bremen, the original one was in wood. It was burned by the archbishop when he captured the town for a little while in the early 15th century. And then they rebuilt it, put a little gate around it. Supposedly, according to legend, they have a copy of it in the basement, because as long as it's there, they're free in Hanseatic. And if it's taken away, they're not. Next slide. I'm going to wrap up with a little bit about just urban life. This is a painting of Augsburg in the early 16th century. I think it's fascinating, but I don't have time to talk about it too much. Next slide. This I wanted to show you guys. This is from Ambrosius Holstein. He's Holbein, I'm sorry. He's Hans Holbein's brother who died young tragically. But it's a street sign for a schoolmaster. These towns had schools going way back, and the sort of subjects that they taught would really surprise you. Quite a bit of really interesting stuff. But this sign's, I think it's beautiful what it says, and it's a rough translation. The sign says, "If anyone be desirous of learning to write and read German, whatever they be, burgher, journeyman, woman, or maiden, whoever need the skill, enter and find here honest teaching at a reasonable price, and if they cannot learn due to being slow like Michael, they may receive their money back. Anno Domini 1560." That's from Basel, where we ended up with a significant university. Next slide. And I was talking about automation before. This is an automated bloomery forge. This is powered by a water mill. It's working the bellows here. This is allowing them to produce a lot of iron, which is why they had so much armor, basically, and they made an advantage for the Europeans. Next slide. Here you see the water wheel. These are stamping mills, which may be associated with a paper mill. That's for grain, but you see some of the machinery associated with it. Next slide. I'm finishing up with some pictures from Strasbourg. These were 17th century, but I think they're really nice. Look at city life there, and they were kind of frozen in time. This is a gunnery range. There's musketeer shooting. You see the target's pretty far away. All these towns had gunnery ranges or crossbow ranges or both. Next slide. Swimming in the Rhine, jumping off the bridge. Looks like a lot of fun to me. Next slide. This is a carnival pageant. Carnival, again, really important in these towns, and it was significant for a lot of reasons that I can't get into right now. But you see like little floats and stuff. Next slide. This is the port. This is their big crane that's not as big as the one in Danzig. Everything was shipped in barrels. The barrel was the shipping container of the day. This could be pickles or gunpowder or herring, but I like to think it's beer because I'm hoping to drink some later. Next slide. So hopefully we learned that many fencing masters and authors of the fencing book manuals, who are not necessarily the same, are part of this estate of the burgher. The most powerful medieval towns, called free cities, were formidable military entities. The burgher was a warlike class expected to fight in the town militia. Craft artisans formed the bulk of the town militia and were required to own and use arms and armor. Journeymen was a subset of the craftsmen who also had their own military training. And the circulation of journeymen was one of many ways that the towns were linked together and also maybe linked to the fence. So that's it, guys. Wants a source material for that stuff, I have it on a jump drive.
So, Jean-Ri, you officially know too much information.
Yeah, sorry about that.
No. Wow. Okay, so, does anybody still have the presence of mind to ask questions?
Sorry for the overload on that.
Yeah.
Mike. I was just curious. Can you explain very briefly? One thing you kind of glossed over, how